All right, welcome back to the show, everybody. If you can't see what I'm wearing, I'm wearing a lovely Tokyo Disneyland mink.
He skinned Mickey Mouse.
I skinned.
Oh no!
Wow,
it's a little chilly in here, but actually, this is really warm.
Right.
So, in this episode of our show, we're going to talk about the trip that Sean and I recently took to Tokyo Disneyland. And let me just start out by saying that, you know, I've traveled quite a bit in my life, and I've seen a lot of places, and there are very few of these places. While they've all been wonderful and they've all had special meaning, there are very few that I would actually say were life-changing, and this was one of them. This was a game-changer for me on a number of levels. I'd never been to Asia. I'd never been to, you know, any of the continents or any of the places in Asia. Never been to any of the theme parks in Asia. And this was a bucket list. And we had plans to do Honolulu or to do Aulani. And Sean mentioned, well, we're halfway to Tokyo because he's heard me talk about it so often. And it just kind of worked out.
Yep.
It just kind of worked out. But as we start this segment, I want to make something clear. We are not experts on Tokyo Disneyland. There are people that know far more than I ever will on this topic. So we are relating our experiences. There may be things that I know there are things that we missed. This is not going to be a comprehensive look at all things Tokyo Disneyland. It's just going to be the experience we had in the planning process, in getting there, and what we discovered once we were there. So, you know, the emails about, oh, you should have done this, you should have done this, next time. So let's start with getting there. Tokyo is not a close flight, even from Honolulu.
Right.
It was still nine and a half hours from Honolulu, which kind of surprised me. But what was weird, it was like 9 hours going there, and it was 6.5 coming back.
Yeah.
So I'm guessing that's the wind and the jet stream or the curve of the earth. I was hearing all these different...
all these reasons as to why everything changed or something. I don't know.
It was just a shorter trip coming back than it was going over. But the best part, though, is that, you know, you have that excitement going over.
Yeah.
And we, the way we did this trip was I did a round trip. We did a round trip on Delta from Orlando to Honolulu. And then we did round trip on Hawaiian Airlines from Honolulu to Tokyo. And we flew in. There are two airports, major airports in the Tokyo area. One is Haneda, which is what we flew into. The other one is Narita, I believe it was. And Haneda was a bit closer, a little bit closer. And just the price point going into Haneda was better. Doing this split trip like that saved a fortune. I was a little nervous because I'd never flown Hawaiian Airlines. Sean had, but I hadn't. And I have to say that I would absolutely fly them again. They were fantastic. The service, the quality. We flew business class, so they had the lie flat seats. It was incredibly comfortable. Food was good. Service was great.
Yeah.
A lot of pink.
Yeah, a lot of the seat decorations.
Everything's kind
of
very stuff. Pink.
They do pink because it's flowery, like the
hibiscus. Kind
of, yeah, so it's all that kind of stuff. So, and they come by as soon as you get on, and they like put your covers on your bed, your lay down bed and stuff for you. It was really nice. I don't know what they do in the back, but
they suffer.
Nobody knows what they do in the back.
They suffer.
So,
in the back.
Yeah. So,
but it definitely saved a lot of money over just doing Delta the entire way. It was a lot of money.
Oh, thousands. Yeah. It was
so I thought that was the best way to do it. And again, it kind of just goes back to the discussion we were having with the Aulani segment, that it really is important to get creative and take a look at a lot of different options. If you just look, you know, when I just looked at doing the whole thing on Delta, I looked at that price and said, well, that's not going to happen. I think a lot of people do that. I think a lot of people, when they travel these far off places, they get tunnel vision about how they go about approaching their airfare.
Right.
And that price point is just a non-starter. So saying, okay, well, what if I use another airline or
right, and you do these types of things. I mean, I've gotten all over the world doing, you know, obviously like Hawaiian, I've only done business class, but with other airlines. I mean, I've flown WOW Airlines, Swoop, there's ANA, there's all these.
You're looking, Pete's so safe when you're flying. Yeah. Wow.
He's making up
Pete's
words,
looking at
right
me
now.
Like, whoa, what are these words that you're saying or whatever? But there are a lot of options.
Well, you know, he would tell me about this and I'm like, well, I'm glad you did those. I would never will. Yeah. So,
but if you want to get to Paris for $200, you can like,
I will take you up on those offers.
Well, the reason I think like this now is because of you, because in you relating these stories of how you've put together a lot of these trips that you've done. He's the king.
Oh yeah, I can get anywhere. So I can get anywhere in a good price. So
he's the king of finding this.
You
stuff.
May not sit well while you're going, but but I can get you there.
So. As soon as we arrived in at Haneda Airport in Tokyo, the difference in culture was very, very obvious.
Immediate. Yeah.
I needed to use the restroom, and I went into a stall in the airport bathroom and gasped out loud because there was no toilet.
Yep.
There was an what I can only describe as an electronic hole
in the ground
in the floor.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what do you expect me to do with that? Okay, there is nothing that I am going to do in this stall that is going to include that hole in the ground, okay? Yep. And I didn't even, I just literally saw it, gasped, turned around, and like looked in another stall to see if there was a better option. And there was an actual toilet. But this was going to be our introduction to electronic toilets that you're not quite sure how to flush. All the toilets in
are complicated.
They're very complicated.
Yeah. I took pictures, but you don't have them to put up there. But
well, actually, when we play the ambassador, I don't think I told you I have the ambassador hotel video up.
It's on Dropbox.
It's on Dropbox. I'm sorry. I put it up this morning. And I forgot to tell you, we're a little ways away from it, so I apologize, Craig. He loves when I do that. I've been very organized so far with this. You got to give me credit. Mm-hmm. That's the only curveball you've got. Don't you give me that. Uh-huh. every bathroom in... Craig is showing, Sean is showing it on his phone.
I was
right
like
now.
Assuming it would be like a little tiny hole or something. I don't know.
It's
I mean, obviously,
hole.
I don't go to men's bathrooms.
Yeah.
But
it's a long hole.
I've seen some bad stuff in Cambodia myself, so it's that like, actually is not that.
This is better than that. Yeah. My friends who have been to like the lower end of East Asia were like, "Oh, that's way better than like Laos and stuff."
Yeah, when you first told me a hole, I thought it was like a hole in the ground.
No, it's an electronic hole.
Yeah, okay.
It was shocking. I was like, "Whoa!" Like
so, but and every bathroom you go into, and I don't care where you are, there is a could you just raise when you get a chance, just raise the volume on my headset, because it sounds so muted and I don't know if the volume coming out of the mixer is low or if
all
it's my headset
variety.
But every bathroom everywhere you go is electronic, and as a result, that's good. These bathrooms are immaculate. I'm going to tell you, I went into a bathroom in a 7-Eleven in downtown Tokyo, and you could have eaten off the floor.
Yep.
That's how clean this city is. Everywhere you go, there's just, it's immaculate. And all the bathrooms have these controls, electronic controls alongside them. They're all the toilets are plugged into the wall, mm-hmm. so don't, you better pray there's no blackouts. And they are a bidet, so you can clean yourself while you're on the toilet. But they also control the flushing. The problem is most of them are all in Japanese. So I'm having to take my phone with Google Translate using the Google Lens and point it at this thing to figure out which button flushes, because it was not immediately apparent to
Thank
me.
Thank you, technology.
Thank you,
For
Google.
Real. because some of them are actually warmers is the thing. Like, so when you do it, that's like there's a whole section that's just heat and like how hot you want the toilet seat to get.
That's wonderful.
Or whatever. And I'm like,
oh, and it's
God.
Also
like,
controlling the temperature of the bidet water.
Yeah.
So
well,
it could be
nice. So it, maybe
well, there's a setting for like women and men and it, like that kind of like there's different.
But it's
settings
all in Japanese.
And, yeah. So
it's all I just
in
want Japanese. A camera on people's faces when they do it. Just
yeah.
To see
like
what, you guys
what
like.
They're
like,
doing.
Oh, my
there's
God.
Also a there's also a music setting yes. on some of them where it will play very like loud music and white noise in case you don't want people to hear you. I was like, there's a
it's
lot.
Cover
happening.
Up noise.
Yeah. I was like, there's a lot happening.
It really is. It really is quite something.
How long until you get one for the house? No. I'm looking forward to this, especially the cover-up noise.
Yeah. I kept saying, like, I don't know if I need... I don't know if I really want a toilet that I have to plug in. there's something about that that just felt unnatural to me. But this was our first exposure to the culture
shock. Yeah,
this
was in the airport.
This was in the airport. I haven't even gotten out of the airport yet. And that was to be, in a very positive way, I will say... But that was to be the way of it for the next week in discovering how different the culture is from ours. No more so than when we actually got to Tokyo Disneyland. And then began this process for me of obviously there's no way I can't compare it to my parks here in Orlando and, of course, in California. And I will say up front right now, our parks suffer greatly in comparison. That includes Disneyland in California, I'm sorry to say. But we'll get to that in a moment. The beginning of our trip, we went from Haneda Airport to the Disney Ambassador Hotel. And it's important now to talk about the booking process for that because,
it's tough.
Folks, I never thought the only area where our parks exceed theirs is in the booking process and the website. First of all, this website is down more than it's up.
Yep.
And the number of times that I had to go to this website at different times of the day praying that I could get on. Like to get general information, you're fine, but to actually book something, the number of times I'd hit that reservation link, I would say five out of seven times. The message would come up, our website is too busy. Then buy more servers, okay? But it was very, very difficult. The other thing was to book a package, you are limited. The maximum number of nights you can book a package for is two.
What?
Yep. Cannot two. Stay longer than two on a package.
On a package, you can. It is a maximum of two nights. Now, you can book multiple packages back to back.
Yeah.
But it is one of the things I had to realize, they are not catering or tailoring any of this to Americans, because as we found out, the number of Americans we ran into the entire time we were there,
like,
we could count on one hand with fingers left over. There just wasn't a lot of Americans, well, more so when we got to the Park Hyatt in Tokyo,
because there's a lot of Americans.
That's here. A more American, proper. It caters more to Americans. But in Tokyo Disneyland, oh no. There was not many. And we also ran into the language barrier, that while many Japanese folks, especially in Disneyland, do speak some English, it's not a lot. And it's very basic. So any conversation that requires any nuance is not going to go well. So, and when I say nuance, I'm talking about, can we ship these packages back to the United States? That required a translator because they just didn't get it. So now, that being said, we had very few problems. It's amazing how many hand gestures and basic words will get you through.
Mm-hmm.
And some people were better than others in terms of speaking English, but... I felt like I probably should have brushed up on a few more Japanese phrases.
I will say also, it's weird because all of their signs, like their road signs, and not just Tokyo Disney, all around Tokyo, are in both Japanese and English.
And English
is written right under it, but no one knows any of the English. I don't know why they bothered. So, because nobody speaks English here. It was a weird choice. Like, I'm like, why is English the other one here? So,
I've always heard that they think that English is like a beautiful language to read, like to see the letters and everything. So I could be wrong with that, but that's why so many different things are in English and in Japanese. Like, and it's not even just the street signs; it's like lots of different things.
It's nice though, because like when you do start to, like as soon as you start talking, and if it's not gonna go well, they or like if it's a no for anything, they hold like both hands up as an and once they do that, I'm like, okay, I'll go to somebody else. That's literally
it's
like
the X block.
Yeah,
it defends against.
Or they do it with they do it with their hands. They'll do this. No.
Did you try using your phone?
Oh, yeah.
Google Translate.
Yeah.
Use that a lot.
A couple times I had to, but not often. Again, for basic conversations, you can get by. But for anything deeper than that, anything, you know, you're not going to sit down to talk over coffee.
Yeah. For some reason, I understood what they were saying. I don't know why. Well, anywhere we went, like we were like, Pete's like, what's going on? I was like, oh, they're saying like, walk over here and do this or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know why I can understand.
He has an ability to pick up languages that's quite extraordinary.
Did you guys pick up any phrases that you can pronounce perfectly for us?
Mm-hmm. I'm an American. I'm an ugly American. No, I did not. All right, so let me talk about these packages. Their packages are very different than ours as well. For example, they have the Experience Attractions 3-day, 2-night plan. This is an adult price of 60,000 to 161,000 yen, Japanese yen, per person, which equates to $531 to $1,425 US. I should mention what the hotels are. Mm. They have, I believe, three hotels. Mm-hmm. There's the Ambassador, there's the Disneyland, Tokyo Disneyland Hotel, and then there's the MiraCosta. Tokyo Disneyland Hotel is attached to Tokyo Disneyland Park. The MiraCosta is attached to Tokyo Disney Sea theme park. And the Ambassador is kind of between the two of them.
Yeah.
The Ambassador, you have to walk a little bit to get there. So it's not right there. But the Ambassador is also part of the Expari complex, which is their downtown Disney.
Is that why you chose it?
No.
No, that was the only thing you could get.
That was all I could, because we booked this a month and a half in advance, and there was no availability at the MiraCosta or the Disneyland Hotel. The Ambassador was all I could get for a package. Now, these packages include a 3-day park admission, and it's a big deal. This is a big deal that the package tickets allow you to go to whichever park you want on any of those 3 days, and you can park hop. The reason that's a big deal is because if you were to buy just a 3-day ticket to Tokyo Disneyland, no package, you have to declare which park you're going to on your first day, which park you are going to on your second day, and on the third day, you're free to go to either park and park hop. Hmm. But on the first and second day, you can. If you say, when you buy the ticket, you have to declare, okay, on this date, I'm going to Tokyo Disneyland. On this date, I'm going to Disney Sea, and that's what you've got to do. Mm-hmm. But on the package tickets, you're free to hop around. These packages, this particular package includes 7 fast passes in total. So you get 1 A-class fast pass, which is good for...
That's everything.
For everything. And then 6 D-class fast passes, which is good for everything except Toy Story Mania, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea.
And a Finding Nemo attraction.
A Finding Nemo attraction.
That we don't have here, so it's different.
This was not the package we booked. But this package includes 2 show viewing tickets. And the shows are a big deal in Tokyo Disneyland, and for good reason. We went and saw...
One Man's Dream 2.
Yeah, Walt's Return.
Yeah, it was literally called One Man's Dream 2.
Yeah, it's One Man's Dream 2.
The Dream Ending.
Yeah.
And
I was like, okay.
I'm like, what? Does he come back to life? What is up about that? But I will tell you, the quality of the entertainment in this stage show was superb.
Yeah.
It was cheesy as hell.
Oh, yeah.
But it was cheese I'll eat. It was so good.
I think they had about 13 costume changes in this 30-minute show.
Yeah.
I've never seen so many. I was like, God, their budget for this show must have been phenomenal.
Yeah, and it was very elaborate sets, the whole nine yards. So you get two show viewing tickets with this. You also get a monorail pass. In Tokyo Disneyland, you pay to ride the monorail.
Yep.
And again, there's a good reason for that. Because this is, as you will see in the video we're going to play in a little bit, I get a little bit of the monorail in there. This is not our monorail system.
Oh, no.
I would gladly pay extra if these were our monorails.
Yeah, they're much nicer.
And you also get two breakfasts on day two and day three of your stay. And you make your arrangement. You make those. You declare what time you want your breakfast when you make the reservation. You declare what days, you know, any reservations you want to make in advance. For anything not associated with the package, if you are booking one of these packages, you can book those 30 days in advance. That's a perk for people staying on site. So on that particular package, I looked at the cost of the Hotel Miracosta, which is absolutely gorgeous. That's the one at Tokyo DisneySea. For that 3 days, two nights, it was a total of $2,044 for two people. But that's including two breakfasts, seven fast passes, two show tickets,
like
3 days
deal.
Park admission, and what is absolutely a first-class luxury hotel.
Yeah.
So you figure it's $1,000 a person.
Yeah. It saves you headache for at least watch two shows.
So
yeah, and the shows, it's really interesting because the shows are, they're packed or whatever. I mean, there's a line that forms hours before the show starts or whatever for people lining up to see it. So that was the only show we got to see, because anything else we would have wanted to watch, we would have been there really early in order to see it. And both parks have a room that's a lottery game. And you go in if you like for firework viewing, Fantasmic viewing, all that kind of stuff. You go in and you insert your ticket and you get a lottery that's somewhat of a game, and if you win, then you get to see the fireworks, essentially.
Or you get
to
VIP area.
You get the VIP area, or you get to see One Man's Dream 2, or whatever. You get guaranteed admission into it. You only get to play once per day, and if you don't get it, then you just don't get it, and that's it. And so it's very randomized on who gets to see
it. But we thought it was a very fair way to do it.
Yeah, because we had as much chance as anyone. So,
but now the package that we did not include show tickets, but it did have eight fast passes. No, it was a total of how many fast? We had a total of 16 fast passes.
16 total, yeah.
We had a total of 16 fast passes. So
is that to share between the two?
Yeah,
then?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
And so we could do, but it is nice because I mean their fast pass system works the same way Disneyland does, without Max Pass or anything. So there's no app that you use. So it is, you walk to the ride, you put your ticket in, and you get a paper back saying this is your return time. So of course this just allowed you to walk up anytime and
anytime fast passes.
Yeah.
And like I said, you know, they have the A class fast passes, which are good for Toy Story Mania, which we didn't care about because it's identical to ours.
Yeah. Nemo.
20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, which was closed for rehab when we were there. And Nemo, which
I said
it was fantastic.
It was cool.
So this was the package that we got, and this package is a little more expensive because of the fast passes, but I felt absolutely, absolutely worth it. But I wasn't sure what to expect because I really wanted either Disneyland Hotel or the Miracosta. But the Ambassador is considered a deluxe hotel, and I wasn't sure what to expect, and I was pleasantly surprised. Can we run the Ambassador video? Here it is.
Thank you.
Okay. So that's a brief look at the Ambassador Hotel, but I want you to pay attention to one of the final scenes in that. You saw Daisy kind of standing behind a banquette, and there was a dad and his daughter looking, you know, with Daisy kind of behind them. I want to explain that to you because it's going to play into a larger narrative that I have to make about the quality of the cast interaction at this resort. That little girl was terrified of the characters. Terrified. She saw them coming and she started crying. But her dad wanted the pictures. So what the characters were doing was they were hiding like behind the banquette where she couldn't see them, yet they could take the picture that had the dad, the daughter, and the character in it with the father's phone so that he could have the pictures.
Right.
And the character, I don't think Daisy was the one who came up with it. I think it was Donald? It was Donald or Minnie? Was the one who was like motioning to her handler how she could get the picture and not upset the kid.
That's cute.
It was Pluto, I think.
We didn't have Pluto.
Either Goofy or Pluto. Whichever was the very first one that came around was the one that did it. Because okay. Everyone that followed suit did it.
Did it.
So,
but it became a narrative at this hotel. So we get into the hotel, and the first thing, again, culture shock. I gave them my passport, which you have to do, and I gave them my credit card. Took my passport, and he pushed my credit card back. I said, "You don't want my credit card?" He's like, "We charge you at the end." I'm like, "What?" Like, wow.
Yeah.
You really are very trusting. and this was to become a theme, as we'll get to, in our experiences in Japan.
A couple other little things from the video. If you go back and see the beds, those are considered queen size beds there. They fit one American. So they do not, they might fit two Japanese people, but they fit one American person. So they also have a pallet ready on the floor. You can kind of see it off to the side because a lot of Japanese people prefer sleeping on the floor instead. So the room technically sleeps like six people or something, like that's what it's listed as, but it's like two, what, and then one on the floor and one on the side there, so it sleeps like eight people. But
no, it would sleep two in each bed, so that's four,
and then one
on the pallet, yeah, so and then six. There was one on that twin bed,
yeah, so you could fit about six, but I wouldn't fit six
again, so. But think about it, the problems we have getting five people in a room,
right?
And this room, now all the space in the room is taken up with beds.
Oh yeah.
You also saw the toilet we were talking about in that video.
The other part of it, you saw a girl leaving that was dressed as Cinderella. That's not a face character there because obviously she didn't look like Cinderella.
She just got married.
She was getting married. So every day we saw, because people were getting married sometimes multiple times a day or whatever, and every time the guy always came out as the prince, and she always came out as Cinderella, and
Cinderella, they got whisked away
and all that. So they dress up as a character to get married and go through the hotel as the character. Yeah. So
wow.
And that's a big deal.
Yeah.
It's a big deal. And they were flawless. I mean, these people were dressed to the nines and they were absolutely flawless in their costumes. What struck both of us almost immediately upon going into the hotel was with the Art Deco design and the woods and the style, it felt like Cruise Line.
Yeah.
It felt like Cruise Line. Even the hallways going to the room felt like you were on a cruise.
Yeah.
Which I was like, wow, that's really kind of cool.
Mm-hmm.
And a very, as you can see from that room, it's not what we're used to. It's not the kind of hotel room we're used to. It was, the beds were very, let's say, hard.
Oh, yeah. I broke my knee. Like, as soon as I got in, I, like, put my knee down on the bed, and I was like, oh, my God. It was like bricks. Yeah, that was a hard bed.
Ooh. So it was definitely, but we slept.
Oh, yeah, I mean, fine. I was so tired.
It was comfortable, and the service in the hotel was absolutely fantastic.
Yeah.
I can't say enough good things about the level of service in the hotel.
We got asked about like hotel location in proximity to the parks. Obviously the Miracosta is literally in Tokyo Disney Sea, so it's like the Grand Californian if you're out in
California.
Out in California. And then the other Tokyo Disneyland hotel would be the equivalent of like the Grand Floridian, I would say. So you walk right across and it's right there. Our hotel is a good in between. So comparing to like California, I'd say like...
Oh, so it was about a 10-minute walk to either park. Yeah. In different directions. You would go one way to go to Disney Sea, another way to go to...
Yeah, so it wasn't far. It wasn't far at all.
This is the other thing when you book the package. This was really weird. Really, really weird. You had to go to the Tokyo Disneyland Welcome Center to pick up your package. It's not at the hotel.
Yeah.
So we got in at like 7:30 at night, 8 o'clock at night. By the time we got into the hotel and into our room, it was 10 o'clock, and this Welcome Center was closed. And the Welcome Center... is located in the same complex where you get the monorail. We're trying to find this the next morning. We want to get into the park, right? We leave the hotel like 7:15, 7:30. Park opened at 9. And we're trying to find this place, and it was really well hidden.
Yeah, for it to be a welcome center.
And again, asking people where it is, they look at you like, qua, or whatever that is in Japanese. And eventually we found it. But this is where you have to have this, because this is where your park admission tickets are. Mm-hmm. This is where you get your fast passes. It's all in this package. Plus, you know, you get to redeem coupons for a popcorn bucket. Mm-hmm. And not just any popcorn buckets. There's some really cool ones mm-hmm. that you can get. And so... Are you grabbing them?
Well, Charles, this one behind you
is that steamboat.
That's the cool
no, that's not. That's well, that's a. I don't know that we could have gotten that one with our pass, but that is a Tokyo Disneyland. But the one that Craig is putting up in front of him, which is Mickey with the 35th anniversary, and I had curry popcorn in that one. There are many different flavors of popcorn, but we'll get to that in a moment. So we finally get our packet.
Yep.
And we get on the monorail. And you'll see in the video we're going to play in a few minutes. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. Which I think is the phrase of this trip for me. Because I kept saying, you got to be kidding me. This monorail was stunning. Stunning. And spacious and like nice upholstered seating and
oh yeah, and even when we say like, oh, you have to pay to ride it, like ours, if we had just had to pay for it individually, it was $11 for the 3 days of like come and go as much as you want. So it's not
unlimited.
Yeah, it's not, and like one ride one way was like, it ended up being about 55 cents I think. So yeah. it was nothing. Yeah. Or whatever. Yeah,
well, I want to draw your attention to the difference in prices for tickets. Let's say you're just buying a ticket. This blows me away. Prices are based on adults, 18 and over, junior, age 12 to 17, and children, age 4 to 11. Under 4 are free. A one-day adult ticket in U.S. dollars is $65.
No.
Yep.
Okay. A junior, your teenager, is $56, and your child is $42. They offer a senior ticket, $65 and over. That's $59. A two-day passport, $116 for adults. One park per day. You have to declare your park. Three-day passport, $157. Day three is your park hopper, so you declare where you're going on day one and day two. Day three, you can hop to both parks. Four-day passport, $198. Day three and four are your park hoppers. Annual passes for both parks range from $570 for kids to $874 for adults.
Mm-hmm.
It's like,
yeah. Okay. And let me say something. Let me say something here. I mentioned this. I kind of started ranting about this in the show, the first show we did this morning. I want to make sure people understand. the park, Tokyo Disneyland, is not owned by Disney. Disney sold the rights for this back in the 80s when they were struggling before Michael Eisner, because they needed the money. They sold the rights to it. So that park is owned by the Oriental Land Company and managed by the Oriental Land Company, and they license the name and they license the rights to use the characters and they license the attractions from Disney. It is absolutely stunning to me that there is a Disney theme park in existence in this world that is so far superior to any product I've seen Disney put out, and it's not run by Disney. A third party runs a better Disney theme park than Disney does. And don't talk to me about crowds, because this park is crowded.
Mm-hmm.
The difference is the people in Japan are respectful. They're not douchebags. Okay? We watch, and you're going to see, and I'm pretty sure I included it in the video. If not, I'll make sure that a picture goes in here when we put this up later. When it's parade time, there's no tape on the ground. There are no ropes being put up. People have their mats that they bring with them. They put them down on the ground. They sit in a perfect line. And nobody is pushing and shoving and trying to get in front at the last minute or any of that. No. It's none of that silent. Goes on.
Like, wow. It's silent the entire time. No one puts – everyone's sitting, so there's no kids on shoulders. There's none of that. Even for the fireworks, whether it's the parade, whether it's anything, they sit in a single file line about 30 minutes before the parade starts. And you could hear a pin drop or whatever, and they don't move. So, and it's not even like the parade passes by and they get up and start running other places. It gets completely gone. They still stay sitting there, and then eventually they get up and go about their day.
It was stunning.
Yeah, it's
and
shocking.
The other thing that, again, because there was a language barrier, when we first got there and I was getting on rides and I was going to film them, because I filmed ride-throughs of many of the rides, and they would do this to me. And I'm like, because they're playing, like when you're in line, they're playing things in English and they're saying, no flash pictures, please. So I, like, you're telling me that, you know, you're saying there's no flash pictures, or sign says no flash pictures, but you're pointing at my camera and doing this. They weren't pointing at my camera. They were pointing at my LCD screen. They were fine as long as I held that camera up to my eye.
I really appreciate that, actually.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I really like
that. There's nobody riding through these rides or standing at the fireworks with the damn iPad.
Yeah, none. Nothing.
It doesn't happen.
None.
This makes me want to go so badly.
I'm wondering if their movie theaters don't have little cell phones on at all times, like if that's just a cultural thing, because you know that I'm you see a screen everywhere you go in every right. dark scenario where you
and trust me, the Japanese were all on their phones. I mean, mm-hmm. everybody has phones. They're just not pulling them out in rides.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they don't pull them out in rides, and I really didn't see them pulling them out that much. They would see them pull them out in lines, like they might get like a selfie together or whatever, but they didn't. It wasn't like in America where you're in line and like you're just texting friends and Googling and stuff. Like, they really were with each other kind of thing, much more so than here.
All right, let's go ahead. I want to, we're going to start talking about our day in Tokyo Disneyland. So let's go ahead and play that video.
Thank you. That is so awesome.
Okay.
This is yours, Sean.
That's great. We need our to pay.
Wait, okay.
Yes, thank you.
どうしてわかるかというと、実はこのカード、裏から見て表がわかる秘密の仕掛けがしたり、とは言っても、カードが少ない。
は？なんでディズニーランドに収容し
So that just kind of was an encapsulation.
That blew my mind, man.
Of our day in Disneyland. And actually, that's a kind of combination of 2 days. But for the first time in years, I did a park. We did a park open and close. We were there when it opened and there when it closed.
Did they close the normal hours like we do? Like,
yeah.
Like, well, midnight?
It was 8 a.m. to 10.
It was like, no, it was
10,
like 9 a.m. to like 9 a.m. to 10
maybe.
Or 11.
Yeah.
Okay. That's a long day.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
And I could have kept going.
Yeah. And all that was just Disneyland. Like, that wasn't Disney Sea.
One of the first things you notice when you go in, their main street is not Main Street. It's called World Bazaar. A lot of the same things, but it's not one long street. It's got two streets coming off of it as well that kind of go around to other areas of the park. Lots of cool little stores. Now, we cannot talk about this park without talking about merchandise. And we have a box full of stuff. So, to give you an example, there is what Katrina is holding right now is a Donald Duck, but you put your hands in him.
To keep
and
him warm.
How plush is that Donald Duck?
It's so nice. I wish we lived in like really cold weather so I could just like bust this out going to the grocery store and people would be like, what are you doing?
If you watch that video back when we put it up on YouTube and pay close attention to the guests in the park, virtually everyone you come across is carrying something like that. They're wearing something. Something is clipped to their backpacks. Something is being worn around their necks. If you go to Charles right now, these are huge. If you go to Charles right now, thank you. These are huge. They like neck pouches.
Yeah.
So that's Oswald. There is a zipper that you can like on top where you can put stuff inside. That's
it's
not
a retractable
zipper.
Thing. Yeah.
If you want to clip that to your belt instead
of
wearing it around
your
neck.
That's awesome. I didn't expect it. That was a nice surprise.
And these are everywhere. And you got a spot in the back where you can hold your ID or your park passes or stuff. And then there's like a little pouch inside. So it's like a wallet. Then I saw this home store, right? They had a home store. And I figured, okay, it's going to be like generic. You know, I think of ours and like what I usually find when I go in. And this was the first store I actually walked into. And if you cut to Tyler.
Yeah.
Tyler was holding this very craft-looking Donald Duck. And I saw they had all the characters in this style. And I absolutely fell in love with them. It's like country, like almost like a homemade, home-sewn version of Donald Duck, and they're absolutely beautiful.
Even down to the tag, I think, is very cool. I know it's going to be hard to see, but I just
let me see that real quick.
Yeah,
this very unique, right? Different. We don't see.
No, I. Stuff. When you pop this out of the bag, I loved this and all the characters.
This was about. This is about $36. This is one of the more expensive items. About $36, but incredibly unique. This is the reason. Stuff like this is the reason. We had to ship 6 boxes back.
Yeah.
Now, Sean is modeling a few things here. Yeah. These are huge, these neck warmers. So this is like, this is not a scarf. This actually just pulls over your head. And they're all wearing them. All the people in the park are wearing these. And then this was like my favorite, this
Figaro.
Plush Figaro. I've never seen a plush Figaro. I'm sure we must have them.
No, I've never seen
it. But
any.
I've never seen it.
I've looked for Figaro before. Yeah, and I can't find him anyway.
Rhino has been playing with the snake from Fantasmic.
Ka.
You could put your hand in it, and he's like a little puppet.
It's like a scarf, a little scarf too.
And he's.
I've been wearing him like a scarf because I was chilly.
The merchandise is completely different. And I honestly felt for the most part. And if you cut back to Sean, if you look over Sean's shoulder, you can kind of see the Jack Skellington. That's a hat.
I
didn't bring my Tigger ears in.
Yeah, he had the long Tigger ears that like stretch all the way down.
And
that are like pockets.
I walked around the park wearing them.
Yeah.
And the reason.
Where are these pictures?
There was one of them on Instagram of him and I. He was wearing.
I was wearing a Winnie the Pooh hat.
I will say this.
If you follow me on Instagram at PeteW126, you will see.
Like with what Charles had earlier with Oswald, a big thing there. Any of these items, like what he had, like that was something men carried even more so than women did, or whatever. There wasn't really a difference in the gendered stuff or whatever. Whereas here we have, you know, the ears or like the headband ears are typically. I don't ever see guys wearing them there.
Like
you
a
would
Minnie
see.
Mouse.
Oh yeah, you would see a group of like 21-year-old guys. Every single one of them would have. You know, one would have a Duffy headband. One would have Toy Story. One would have Donald. Whatever. Like
some would have Minnie, and these were. It wasn't like. Forgive me for being stereotypical. This wasn't a group of gay guys. These were guys there with their girlfriends.
Oh, yeah.
Clearly there with their girlfriends.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they were like, you know, late teens, early 20s. Like, for us, these guys, American teenagers,
it's just not
would
something
not be caught
they would do.
Dead.
Yeah.
Wouldn't be caught dead wearing that. Yet it was just, they just embraced it. And I said to Sean that, you know, there's something really cool about that, that vibe of just really having fun in the park. And that, I'm not saying this is true of everybody. I'm speaking for myself. I wouldn't dream of doing here. And it made me think about that. It made me think, why wouldn't I do that here?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
because I'm a 54-year-old man. Well, I'm a 54-year-old man who makes his living talking about theme parks. So why not go the rest of the way and put a damn hat on?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And but, you know, this thing I was wearing, the Mickey ear fur, the number of guys walking around the park with that would blow your mind.
They had Murray the Cat from Aristocats or whatever, and they would just wear it like it was nothing, and which is shocking for here because that's not something you would see a group of 21-year-old guys wearing. Like,
and lest anyone misinterpret, I'm not mocking them at all.
Oh, no, it's cool.
I'll say this, and it will shock people. If you'd given me another week in that park, I probably would have had a Duffy.
Okay. Now, I want all of this conversation.
I understand Duffy more now. I'm sorry. I understand, seriously, I understand more now after being there why Duffy is so popular.
Don't they have like Duffy photo spots too where you can put your Duffy on like a certain ledge?
Oh, they
so
would.
They're all about Duffy.
If you look at that video that I that we played, when we're in front of Big Thunder Mountain, there's a group of girls lining up what appeared to be stuffed pigs to take a picture like that.
Oh, okay.
So yeah. I guess that would be a thing there.
Yeah.
But Charles, you were going to say something?
Oh, yeah. I just want all of this on record and brought back up when you try and make fun of me when I'm dressed like a Jedi for Galaxy's Edge. I'm going to remind you that I'm totally in the spirit, just like I would be in Tokyo.
Okay. Yep. All right.
I think while we're talking about merchandise, though, we really need to show that popcorn bucket off right back there because we haven't showed it yet.
Yeah.
That one needs to get on camera because that's like one of my favorite things that they brought back and I'm super jealous of.
Yeah,
if you watched the Rhino's segment, it was in front of me for the entire thing. But if you didn't watch Rhino's segment, here's the debut right now. Oh.
Yes.
This is a Steamboat Willie popcorn bucket. It squeaks up on top, and then if you open up the top there, Charles, that's where the popcorn went. And that whole bottom part of this boat is the popcorn well.
It looks like it floats too, right?
I
would have to float. You could eat this in the bathtub, right?
Look for that Patreon exclusive video of Charles with the man.
So merchandise is a big thing there, and for those of us who are only used to the U.S. parks, the difference in the merchandise was stunning. And the fact that it's not homogenized in every, you're not seeing the same things everywhere you go. Mm. There was different stuff depending on where you were, the way God intended. Not like what we do, where it doesn't matter what store you walk into, you're seeing the same crap. Mm-hmm. And I will also say, in my opinion, the quality of the merchandise, far superior.
And
far superior.
The prices are really great. I mean, even with the popcorn or whatever, a refill on popcorn is 35 cents.
How long was
it
to get
be
the
for
popcorn?
Popcorn? Oh, like nothing. Or whatever, like there's no line at all. Like you just
some. It depended. There were some places that
the
had
chocolate
lines.
Because of the flavors.
Yeah, all of them were different flavors.
What was the best flavor that you guys had?
Curry. The curry popcorn was the best for me. You like the milk chocolate one.
I like the chocolate popcorn.
They had a caramel popcorn, but it wasn't like our caramel popcorn. It was popcorn with caramel in it. Same thing with the milk chocolate. It was like a milk chocolate flavoring added to it, but there were also chunks of milk chocolate in the popcorn. But they don't salt. Salt is not a thing in Japan. When you go to eat, there's no salt on the table. When you ask them for salt, they look at you like you're insane. The same thing is true with sweetener. If you use sweetener in your coffee, bring it with you because they don't use it. So you even go to a Starbucks and get a cup of coffee. When you go to fix it, it's sugar and gum syrup, whatever gum syrup is. I imagine it's like a simple syrup. Thankfully, I brought mine with me. So things like that, again, culturally very different. Attractions-wise, some of the attractions are the same as either the ones we have here or the ones that were in Disneyland. Pirates of the Caribbean, and we are putting up ride-throughs of these. I don't know what the timing on that is. Craig will...
Sprinkling.
Yeah. Craig's slowly releasing them. But our Pirates of the Caribbean, their Pirates of the Caribbean is kind of like a blend of California's and ours.
Yeah.
It's not quite as long as California's, not quite as short as ours. Haunted Mansion is the same normally, I believe, but their Haunted Mansion holiday was very different than what it was in California. Yeah. I thought it was superior,
honestly. I loved Zero in the ballroom scene.
Yeah.
That was the cutest thing.
I
was
like, I loved the little vampire Teddy on the piano.
That
was my favorite thing that I saw.
Yeah. Space Mountain, their Space Mountain is very similar to Disneyland's. The loading area is different. They had that really cool spaceship.
Yeah.
Buzz Lightyear was the same as Disneyland's. Yeah, but again, the stuff is in Japanese too, so.
Yeah, so it's a little bit different. Some of the major changed ones was that were some of my favorites was Monsters, Inc. We actually used a fast pass for that, which I'm really glad we did because the wait was about an hour and we were like, we think it's going to be about the same like as California's Monsters, Inc. And it is a similar ride setup, but it's cool because they give you a flashlight whenever you get on and you... There's these markers all through the ride, and you have to flash the flashlight onto the markers, and that activates the animatronics. So if you don't flash on them, they won't go. So it ends up being very interactive. Besides that, I'm trying to think. You know, Country Bear Jamboree was a Christmas version there.
Which we don't do anymore. You guys don't do it anymore.
Well, we got rid of our Country Bear, but we did used to have the Christmas one in Disneyland.
And what was cool is that... parts of it are in Japanese, and then the songs are in English.
Yeah,
some of the songs are in English.
Yeah,
so it was very, very cool. The blend of that.
Also, you got to see a bit of their Enchanted Tiki Room. That is like a Stitch takeover. So it is a Enchanted Tiki Room mixed with Lilo and Stitch blend.
It was very cool too.
It was neat.
We had a good time there. And again, that whole show is in Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
So we had no idea what was going on. Some of these attractions, they would give you
a box
so you can translate. You can get a translation of what's going on.
Yeah.
But I, even though I didn't understand what was going on, it was just cool.
Yeah.
It was just cool being there.
You guys have to talk about the what ride looks the most changed to me, which is the Winnie the Pooh ride.
I want to talk about Winnie the Pooh. This is a ride Sean and I went on three times. It's the only ride we went on three times. It is my favorite ride in either of those two parks.
It was amazing. Yeah. If you've ever been to SeaWorld in Orlando, there is a penguin ride that works on a magnet kind of situation. So it's similar to that, but it's more free roaming.
I was going
to
say, it looked like from that video, it looked like the honey parts aren't on a track.
No, they're trackless. And so you go in like a set of three honey pots filled with people. So you might go in one time and, in the blustery day scene, you're going to go over by Rabbit's part of it, which in the video you saw that. If you're in a different honeypot, you might go over by Eeyore's section of it. Mm-hmm. So depending on when you ride and which times, it's going to be a little bit different of a show. So it gave some rewrite ability and stuff. And it was awesome.
And that's even cooler. We'll get to see in Epcot in a couple years, but in Paris, the Ratatouille attraction, all the rats are moving together, but based on which rat you're in, you're going to end up at a different location when you make each stop. So this actually sounds even cooler.
You also, at one point, you go into a dark room and Tigger, three screens around you, and Tigger shows up and Tigger starts bouncing. And as Tigger is bouncing, so is the floor.
Hydraulics of the floor. Oh, the whole room
are bouncing with him.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
That's cool.
And I likened the experience on this attraction in a way, with the quality of the story, the animatronics, the design, the Imagineering, to Splash Mountain, but done without water and for Winnie the Pooh. That's what it felt like to me. It reminded me a lot of the experience of going through Splash Mountain. It was absolutely fantastic, and so much so that we used a fast pass on it twice.
Yep.
And the third time, we decided to wait in the hour and 10-minute line in the rain.
And oh, yep, wow. we still
That's
did it.
That's dedication.
I waited an hour and 10 minutes for a ride in the rain. That's how good it was.
Yeah.
That's how good
I will it was. Also say Tokyo Disney and just the area in general, as you see the videos, the merchandise we held, the main collaboration with them is animals. They really don't care that much about the human characters, it seems. They like the animal characters. They like Mickey, Donald, Goofy kind of situation, but they also, you know, Lady and the Tramp was big, 101 Dalmatians, Aristocats, Winnie the Pooh, any animal, like Duffy, any animalistic kind of characters is what they wore, bought, everything.
I was going to ask if there was even a Peter Pan attraction there.
There is a Peter Pan attraction, but there is not princess meet and greets there. You can't meet the princess.
Princesses move aside.
And, and even generally speaking, character meet and greets were not...
They're not prevalent.
It's not prevalent.
But you can't meet the princesses at all.
I didn't see any.
They may be there.
Again, this is one of those things I was saying at the beginning. They may be there and we just didn't see them or we didn't know. But it's not like it. Character meet and greets, it's not like they are here. You'll see some walking around like you saw in the video with some of the country bears walking around and Jesse walking around. It's not the same as it is here.
Is that why they don't have such an issue with people when they do weddings and stuff like that, dressing up as the princes and princesses?
Maybe.
That might because be they don't have those characters wandering the parks?
I don't know.
Right. They'd also have to get people that look like them, which would be very difficult. I mean, I stuck out like a sore thumb, so it wasn't like me walking around. Like, I was way different than everybody else there. So you'd really have to, like, fly people in for this. So it's you're not getting locals to be Cinderella or whatever because they just don't look like
Cinderella.
Well, but
that's not a problem because a lot of the people in entertainment are Americans.
Right. Yeah.
We were in Starbucks getting a coffee, and the woman in front of me had just gotten there from Orlando. She was hired to be in entertainment. She's in one of the shows in the Broadway show in
at Disney
Sea. So I got to move this along a little bit because we're running long.
Can I ask you the question about mobility in the park?
You know, from what we could tell, it's a fairly accessible park, and they do say on their website that there are no barriers.
Okay.
Did not see a lot of people either in wheelchairs or in ECVs.
I think I saw one the whole time.
Yeah.
Poo-sized people?
There aren't any.
No.
Okay, because I got that question, too. Did you find I'll rephrase it like this. Did you find that like ride vehicles, seats and stuff like that seemed to be smaller about
no,
the same?
No, I didn't find them.
The only one I can think.
Nothing that stuck out to me.
Okay. The Journey to the Center of the Earth was kind of small. Like that would be tight. But besides that,
that's
nothing.
Over in Disney Sea.
Yeah. Even then, I would say if you don't have any problem with anything at Universal, I don't think you would run into any issues here. So,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I never felt like, wow, okay, there's a size difference here. Not like we did with the beds in the hotel.
Yeah.
All right, so let's move over to Tokyo Disney Sea.
Mm-hmm.
Widely considered by many people I've spoken to be the most beautiful Disney theme park in the world, and while I haven't been to Hong Kong or Shanghai yet, I am inclined to agree. I barely rode anything in this park because all I could do was walk around. I had to walk around. Every time you turn around, every time you turn a corner, my jaw was on the floor. And again, I literally just started saying out loud, "You have got to be kidding me." Absolutely. You know what? Run the video.
Ahoy, everyone. Welcome.
Thank you.
God, I want to go back. The most beautiful theme park I've ever stepped foot in.
Yeah. And I honest to God, that video didn't even do it justice. It was a great video and stuff, but like in your head, how immersive everything was. It was so amazing.
And I understand some of the comments that people have made about line of sight theming, that, you know, you'll notice there was one scene there where I was shooting the wharf, like it was like a New England wharf area, and there was a volcano behind it. You're in Venice, and you can kind of see New York from there. I understand that, but you know what? As I'm walking to Haunted Mansion, I'm staring at Rapunzel's Tower. I didn't realize Rapunzel's Tower was in the Hudson area of New York.
See, when I watched that video, what it kind of looked like to me, because I know you were talking about this when you first got back, but it reminds me of like if a cartoon artist drew a map and they kind of like put it together, it would be like I'm in the map almost. So it's like that kind of line of sight is part of the theming, is what it looks like.
Whether it is or not, it doesn't matter because it's absolutely spectacular.
Oh yeah.
Okay, I can't stress this enough. I am telling you right now, Tokyo DisneySea is worth getting on a plane and flying 16 hours from the East Coast to go to Tokyo and walk in that park if you are a Disney fan. It is an expensive trip. It is a long trip, but oh my God, is it worth it. That park alone, I loved Tokyo Disneyland Park. There was so much about that park that was just fantastic and very familiar. Familiar but different. Mm-hmm. And the differences were really fun to discover and explore. Tokyo DisneySea, you just don't have any point of reference. I can't say Epcot. I can't say Islands of Adventure. I can't say any of that. I can't, because it's just its own thing. And as you walk around, you walk in to the Mediterranean Harbor area, and it's huge. The park is huge. Mm-hmm. And it's just so, everything is so perfectly themed. And then you turn a corner and you're in this, you know, in this, where that volcano is that you see in most of the shots. That's where Journey to the Center of the Earth attraction is. That's what 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea area is. It's all very steampunk. Very, very cool vibe. 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea was in rehab. But we have a ride through of Journey to the Center of the Earth that will go up at some point. I was blown away by how good this attraction was.
It was like a fun Navi River journey.
Wow. It was...
Shade.
Yeah, really. I would say it was kind of more like a tame Expedition Everest.
Some blend of the two.
Is it a boat ride? Yeah.
No, it's a roller coaster.
It starts as like a boat
coaster.
Ride, and then becomes a roller coaster.
It was never a boat ride.
Well, not a boat, but
you're
saying
a roller coaster.
I'm just talking about the speed or whatever.
Right.
It starts slow like Navi River Journey, but gets fast like a boat ride.
Similar technology to the test track, right? And
yeah.
And cars.
Yeah. I feel like it's similar to that. Yeah.
This was a roller coaster.
I have a question, though, just about the general size of this park. Is there a theme park in the United States you could compare it to size-wise? It looked really big in that video.
It's a little bigger than Epcot, but I feel like Epcot's the biggest park I can think of.
I don't know. Yeah. It felt a lot bigger than Epcot to me.
Oh, it is, really? But okay. I'm just saying reference-wise, like walking from front to the end.
Yeah, Epcot is the closest.
Okay.
But I think it was bigger than Epcot.
I'm fairly certain. Somebody can look it up. What the actual size of it is versus Epcot, but it felt a lot bigger than Epcot to me. And again, now if you're a Duffy fan, this is your park, because I didn't see any Duffy stuff at all in Tokyo Disneyland. Duffy was all up in DisneySea.
Yeah.
You see that one shot of McDuck's department store? That store is nothing but Duffy, floor to ceiling, front to back.
What?
It's all Duffy. I walked in, looked around, said, okay, I'm done, and walked out. But
one of my favorites, like you got to see it some in the video, is Aquatopia. You saw the hovercrafts out on the water, and I dislike Autopia and Tomorrowland Speedway very much. And so I was like, oh, do they have anything similar to that here or whatever? Because we didn't see it at Disneyland or at Tokyo Disneyland. And you get there, and I'm like, this is amazing that you can do this with the hovercrafts and stuff and get on there. It's like a continuous ride, so it's not like, oh, move everybody out and all that. It's a constantly moving attraction, so it was amazing. Like, I loved that so much.
And I forgot to mention something. I've talked about the cast member experiences, and if we go back to the video we showed of Tokyo Disneyland Park, you'll see that server in the restaurant that was riding on our she had asked us if this was our first time to Tokyo Disneyland, and we said yes. And she went and she got these first-time visitor stickers and hand-drew characters on them and hand-drew our names and then put the little Disney, the Mickey Mouse stickers up in the corner to kind of make ears. It's not done. It's not done. She sat there for like 5 minutes and hand-drew everything.
Beautiful.
Yeah. And they were gorgeous.
Yeah. I was saying, also in the area, like speaking to that, the area that has like Indiana Jones and a few rides like that, that's more jungle themed, leaves that had fallen off the trees. There were cast members that were using the leaves to make characters on the ground.
Yes.
Like the leaves that fell. So that was really cool. And, go ahead. There was something else. I'll
no,
come
go
back
ahead.
To it. No, I can't remember. I'll come back. Well, like, it was left my brain. I know what it was. There was we kept running into, at one point, there was an employee that had the garbage can open, and she had literally been over by the garbage can for the longest. So I went over to see what is she doing, because I don't know what's happening. She was organizing the garbage. So like she was their custodian person, but literally they had opened it and were like taking all the cups and stacking them in each other, taking all the forks and putting them in a section so you could fit more in the garbage can. And so that it was like cleaner inside the garbage. And I was like, you know, this is trash, right?
And literally also separating out the recyclables.
Separating out the recycling that was there. And I was like, oh my God, like they're so like they're organizing the garbage. Like,
I can't begin to tell you what it's like to walk through a Disney theme park and interact with. I mean, it was crowded. You know, I won't lie. And now I think we were dealing with lower crowds than is normal. I think we got very lucky. Especially on the weekend, it gets crazy. I can't tell you what it's like though to walk through a theme park with pleasant people who are respectful.
So no bumping, no strollers hitting your legs,
no,
or anything like that.
No. And interact with cast member after cast member who's not only friendly, but clearly very happy to be there.
Yeah.
So when I said earlier that this experience shows me how far we have gotten away from what we used to be. Mm-hmm. And they're able to do it at half the price that we charge. I didn't think the food was overpriced by any stretch of the imagination. Huh. I did not think the merchandise was overpriced by any stretch of the imagination. And I certainly don't think anybody can look at the price of their passes, their admission passes, and say they are outrageous. I think for look, this was not a cheap trip. I felt like I more than got my money's worth for the experience. I can't wait to go back. But it made me so angry at our parks, especially here in Orlando, that this company that isn't even Disney runs a better park than they do. That you don't feel like you're walking through a money grab conveyor belt. That there's actually concern for the quality of the experience and the experience of the guest, as opposed to how much money can we soak out of you and how quickly can we do it? Because that is what Walt Disney World has turned into. It is a money grab. And I defend them on any number of things. They are a business. We are a capitalist society. I realize it's a different culture. in Asia. It's a different culture in Japan. I understand that. But I really think there's a lot, as guests and as businesses, we can borrow from what they do. Because Tokyo Disneyland makes it clear that you can have crowds and you can have world-class entertainment and you can be respectful. I can't use the expression I want to use. And not feel and walk out not feeling like you were just violated by a company. That's how I feel coming back from Tokyo Disneyland. That it was, when I say it was a game changer for me, I'm sorry, domestic U.S. parks can't hold a candle.
And I will say, like, even to hearken on that, I feel bad just because, I mean, obviously I love the United States and everything like that, but it really was that way everywhere in Tokyo. Everywhere we went, everyone was so nice. They were so friendly, respectful, even when it's a crowd. And like, you know, when you go in Haunted Mansion and there's the whole crowd of people beside you, in ours, there's just people like talking and yelling and pushing and shoving. None of that. Everyone was silent. When you're getting to the point for the ride, they're like, go in front of me, go in front of me. Like, they're literally orderly and lining up to do it. And you just come back. And for the longest time, I've been going to our parks and people come to visit and I go and I'm there a couple of hours with them. And I make excuses not to have to go at park open with them. I don't want to stay until park close. I don't even bother watching the fireworks anymore at this point because I just can't with the crowds and the workers screaming and people with their iPads and stuff. And I just don't do it anymore. And I had wondered for a bit, I'm like, maybe I'm just like losing it with Disney. Like, I don't know what the problem is, but going here, I was like, I've done open to close like 3 days in a row. Mm-hmm. I still feel energized. And that's how I used to feel when I didn't live here. And I thought, well, maybe it was the problem because I live here in the area. Maybe that's made me like less appreciative of it. And I was like, no, I think it's a mix of the two. Like, I this is refreshing and it's new, but it's also really nice to not have people like shoving you and like, you know, being herded like cattle around places.
And,
so
and honestly, 3 days was not nearly enough. I absolutely could have used three more days because I really wanted to explore so much more of those parks. There's so much we didn't get to see.
I know this is running a little bit longer than you want, but can you guys just briefly maybe comment on the food again really quick? Somebody asked about that in the chat room. You didn't speak too much.
Okay, so I'll give you an example. The Hungry Bear restaurant was all curry.
That's like unheard of.
Right. It's all curry.
You know?
It is not. The food is very different. I will tell you now, if you are trying to follow a ketogenic diet, give it up when mm-hmm. you go to Tokyo, because it's just not going to happen.
Right.
There was no doing keto for me, and I just had to embrace that at some point. It's like, I'm either going to starve, or... but I was doing enough walking around that it mitigated.
I'll say the restaurant, not as far as sit-down restaurants go, but even with those, if you're going to do a sit-down restaurant, a menu's typically going to have three choices on it. Two, maybe three. Any counter service that you go up to, it's a one thing. So if you're going in a line for pizza, there were two options. There was ham and pineapple or shrimp. Was the two different pizza options. That's it. You get one slice, that type of thing. Like, that's where you go. There was another line that was just bao buns with, you know, pork belly in it. That's the only item that they sell. So if you want French fries, that's another aisle, like, down somewhere else. So
it was like that in some places, but not...
Overall, that's how it was. It was very split in that way. So, I mean, I thought that was nice. It turned out people really fast.
But you discovered fried chicken.
Very quickly. Yeah, I had fried chicken that was there. You couldn't get ketchup or anything to go on it, because I asked, and they were like...
Hold up. Ketchup on your fried chicken?
Yeah. I like ketchup. I like ketchup on my fried chicken.
Cut the mic. Cut his mic.
I enjoyed it, but the only condiment they really had for use there was lemon juice. That was everywhere had lemon juice to put on anything. Like, it was at the pizza place, it was at chicken, it was everywhere, and they always put lemon juice on everything.
Yeah.
But beyond that, I mean, the food was okay. I didn't think that it was anything like right. I wasn't thrilled about the food, but
it is definitely a different palate than we're used to. And so some measure of that needs to be considered when you go.
Yeah.
We didn't starve. We were able to find places to eat. One of the one of the videos, one of the spots in the video was Magellan's restaurant in Tokyo Disney Sea. That meal was amazing. That meal was absolutely amazing. Very, very good meal. And that was more of a gourmet meal. That was one of their more, that was one of their signature restaurants. So there are options, but like, you know, we showed the Chef Mickey's buffet and a breakfast buffet at the Ambassador Hotel. You had two sides to it. You had a more Western, and this was common. You had a more Western menu or a buffet side, and then you had a more Asian side. But even the Western side, like the breakfast sausage tasted like hot dogs. The bacon was not any kind of bacon I've ever seen before. It's not like the bacon I see in Europe. It was, I don't know how to describe it other than it looked like it really wasn't cooked.
Yeah, it looked raw.
And, oh, not my bacon.
And so, I don't wanna like...
Hashtag not my bacon.
So, you know, there was a lot of, you know, the food definitely was a bit of a challenge. At no point, the only thing like really that like, wow, this is so good. In Tokyo Disney Sea, Sean found a cart that had
Hot Pockets.
They weren't like so they weren't like the brand name Hot Pockets. There was their version of them, but they were amazing. They were better than our Hot Pockets.
I had so many Hot Pockets.
Yeah, he was like, I kept
going back to the Hot Pockets.
Did you put ketchup on it?
No.
Okay, good.
They didn't have
it. Okay. Don't do it.
So
did they burn your mouth?
No.
Actually, it's definitely
figured out the science.
It's definitely a different palate than what we're used to. But that's part of what you embrace. But we have to. Unfortunately, we're running over. We've got to wrap up. But I want to sum up the experience of dealing with the people in Tokyo with this one story. Once we left Tokyo Disneyland and we went to stay in downtown Tokyo, stayed at the Park Hyatt, and I shared on social media some of the experiences I had in the Park Hyatt. And if you have the opportunity to stay in the Park Hyatt in Tokyo, absolutely do it. Best hotel I've ever stayed in my life, hands down, incredible, incredible hotel. But we went exploring. Sean had set up a couple of days for us to explore. And the first stop was over to the Imperial Palace in Tokyo. And as we're walking in, there was a group of college students, five college students, that approached us and said, asked us if we spoke English. And I said, yes, we did. Or Sean's like, yes, we do. And they said, we're trying to improve our English. Could we take you, like, give you a guided tour of this area? And Sean was like, oh, absolutely. And Jersey over here is like, how much? And they looked at me horrified. Oh, no, no money, no money. We want to learn English. All right. You're going to hit me up for money, but let's go. You seem like a nice kid. So we go into this area with them, and I'm just waiting. I'm waiting for the other shoe to drop. Guess what? It never dropped. Wow. They were five college students, all studying law and... You know,
linguistics
and
international relations.
And as an extracurricular activity, it's not part of their curriculum with college. This is a club to learn English. And this is what they do, is they will go to areas that may have American tourists or English-speaking tourists, and they will ask. And engaging us in conversation helps them improve. They were asking us all about, you know, life in America and life in Orlando, and most of them have never been here. They were the most charming group of people we could have possibly met. They wanted, and it was, after spending an hour going through this area with them, I realized that, no, these guys were not, you know, looking for anything other than to just learn better English. So we invited them to have lunch with us, and we went and we had lunch. They took us to a little local place and this train station, and we had this like really cool Japanese meal with these local Japanese college kids. And it really dawned on me, this is just a different culture. It's a completely different culture, and I'm very proud of where I'm from. I love my country, but there's a lot we could learn from the Japanese, is all I'm going to say. We can learn a lot. But that story for me embodies the experience with the cast members at Tokyo Disneyland, the people that we met as we went through our week in Tokyo, kind, respectful, genuine, just lovely people. And it made the experience even better than it would have been otherwise, I think. So that is our discussion on Tokyo Disneyland and our trip. We hope you enjoyed it.